So good morning, everyone. So we have a very interesting panel today. We have Noopur, Raval, who is a PhD researcher at the University of California, Irvine. Her research looks at the social impact of the ride-sharing technologies. She's interested in geography and navigation technology and is the moderator for today's panel, which is Business of Geospatial Data in Asia, Industry Experts. So over to you, Noopur.
Hi. So this is how the panel will go, is that I'll invite the speakers onto the stage and we'll have them speak one after another. And then we'll have sort of a Q&A and a discussion after each of them speaks. I think it would be better to hold off the questions until everybody's spoken so that we have enough time to kind of relate the questions back and forth. So I'd just like to invite the speakers on stage. Pradeep and Anasuya, please. And Mr. Shikant, please. Okay. So I'll just briefly introduce all the speakers that we have today. Thank you all for joining us. I'm so glad you could make it. Mr. Pradeep BV is the lead geo at Grab. He's sitting in between. Anasuya Datta is the executive editor of the Geospatial Media Publication and Communications. And Mr. Shrikant Rao is the associate director and lead industry practice, software and platform at Accenture Technology. I'll just kind of set the stage for what we're going to talk about in this panel and sort of how we conceived it and why we want to talk about it. So bear with me while I read a little bit. According to a 2016 study by Google and Temasek, the total first-hand e-commerce market in Southeast Asia is expected to reach almost $88 billion USD by 2025, significantly outpacing the growth of offline retail, with the potential to reach $120 billion. And this is, of course, without counting China or India. So commerce, as it combines online buying experience with the offline logistical operations, is undoubtedly a key driver of the geospatial data industry in the region. But the geospatial data industry is not just limited and driven by the logistical needs of delivery companies of all scale, but also by internet-connected devices that are moving across, including mobile phones, wearables, public and private transport, and all other kinds of things that you can think of. OpenStreetMap is located within this massive and expanding geospatial data ecosystem, and with the potential of enabling fundamental disruptions by bringing in situated information on the one hand and functioning with common spatial data repositories on the other hand, it makes for a very deadly combination. And this is kind of why we brought together this panel discussion to get sort of industry and non-industry insider perspectives on what it means to be in the business of geospatial data within the Asian context. I'd like to invite our first speaker, Pradeep, to take the stage whenever you're ready.
Fantastic. How many of you not? How many of you too lazy to lift up your hand? Anyway, thank you. I did get somebody there. Anyway, fantastic. So what does Geo do in Grab? So Grab is a ride hailing company. We operate in Southeast Asia. We do far more things than just ride hailing. Do a whole lot of stuff, right? So this is a typical traffic. No surprise for most of the people in the room here, right? And then again, this is what it results in. Okay, when you have so many things happening, you get so much stuff, right? So the question then becomes, hey, you have so many things happening, you get so much stuff. Okay, so what are you going to do with that, right? Anyway, so no secrets, everything is very understood that, hey, there are a bunch of people who want to go from place A to place B, bunch of people who want to order stuff from place A to place B, how do things matter, so this is where things matter, right? And then again, there are various modes through which all of these things are enabled. You need to know where are the drivers, what are your preferences, you also need to know where is the demand, how is it going to work, right? So more the better data you have, more all of those things happen. So you need to know where the passengers are and as well as their preferences. it makes a huge difference to understand when the passenger is in a hurry versus when, hey, they just need to go for a ride. Because if the passenger is in a hurry, the ETA becomes very, very critical. If I show 5 minutes, you better arrive in 5 minutes. If not, they'll say, man, I missed the flight. You made it happen. Or you made me miss my flight kind of stuff, right? And then how do you ensure that, hey, things become much easier and all of that stuff, right? So essentially, this is where the whole thing comes down to. What does location mean, right? So in a very simple thing, so I heard many of you saying that, hey, you have taken a ride. How many of you have been taken for a ride? Okay, see? Okay, pricing went horribly wrong. ETA went horribly wrong. Driver didn't arrive. Or driver arrived at some other place you were waiting here. Some of us also have been taken for a ride, and everything boils down to location. If things around your location is not right, so this is the difference between getting on a ride versus being taken for a ride. Right? Anyway, so the message that I want to leave with you guys is I think there are lots that an organization like Grab could do, and many of that is powered by the community that sits out here. And then there could be lots much more that we could do once you start engaging with the broader stakeholders out there, be it governments, be it cities, be it citizens. There could be a lot that we could do together. We are very happy to be here in this platform. And I'm personally also pretty happy because 10 years ago when we started out the first OpenStreetMap event out here in Bangalore, it was held in IIM Bangalore. And like my startup at the time used to be incubated here at NSSL. And later came back as a student here in 2012. So it's like a homecoming for me. So I'm very, very happy to talk to each one of you to understand how and how we could collaborate with you, work with you from the Grab perspective. Anything that you want to do in Southeast Asia, any support that you need, or any ways that Grab could use your help and expertise, we'd be happy to learn from you, understand from you, and share with you. Thank you.
Yeah, good morning, friends. Yes, so my topic for today is this been working? Geospatial data in India. I understand the panel is about Asia and more focusing on Southeast Asia, but the issues that I'll be talking about, we don't really have a lot of data. The geospatial economy, the market size available for Asian market per se. And India anyway remains the biggest market for the South Asian market. So before I proceed further, a quick insight into what we do. Geospatial Media and Communications is a global knowledge platform. So we have three divisions. We work through three divisions, media and public relations. The one that I represent. So we have a media platform that's the world's biggest media platform on geospatial technologies, and we which operates under the brand Geospatial World. So we have a magazine and a multimedia platform. The outreach and business development in common parlance is what is into conferences, and we do such events to bring all kinds of stakeholders, including the geospatial community as well as enthusiasts and the user community on platform. And the third division is market intelligence and policy advocacy, which is into research and focuses on capturing the impact and implication of geospatial technology. So why are we here today? Because this is because maps are not just driving apps. As Noopur started her panel, the introduction saying they are much more than driving your apps, driving your ride share, driving your cab, or maybe delivering your e-commerce to your home. They are driving economies too. So in this increasingly interconnected world, one of the most powerful way of exploring the physical and digital landscapes for businesses is and governments is through the way dimension. And where does India feature in this? So value of maps in Indian economy. If you see, in 2010, McKinsey Institute had reported that land market distortion in India leads to 1.3% loss in GDP annually. Now you calculate it. This amounts to 34.5 billion each year at current values. Indian GDP is valued at 26 $2.6 trillion. In other words, effective use of mapping and digital technologies in our land records management can unlock $34 billion. This is, just to give you a perspective, this is almost equal to FDI equity inflows into India between April and December, just that period, making it one of the top FDI destinations in the world. So that was 2010 figures, and we have just extrapolated the old McKinsey figures onto the current GDP. So 8 years have passed. We just presume that the figure will be more than what it was in 2010. So what is happening in India? In 2011, Economist had accused the Indian government of censorship over maps when it was forced to stick blank white stickers over maps of Kashmir on 30,000 copies to be distributed in the country. In early 2016, this is a Geospatial World magazine, we got a notice from the Survey of India asking us to explain why we should not be prosecuted for publishing this distorted map of India, when our intention just was to highlight how easily maps are available on the internet, and stopping publishing of such distorted maps will not deter terrorists. This was just after the Pathankot attack. Anyway, nevertheless, the law was the law, the existing law, which stands still today. We duly apologized and withdrew the magazine from the market. That was February 2016, this was May 2016. India government drafted a bill which was known as the Geospatial Data Regulation Bill, as per which if you depict India's map, you could face like up to seven years in jail and fine up to 100 crores, something that doesn't exist. Agree with the government version. And finally, maps grabbed the headlines. It was there everywhere on mainstream media, even TV channels went hammer and tongs of the government. Finally, the government relented. The bill has gone into, that particular bill has gone into cold storage, but the existing, the 2008 national mapping policy still remains. But how did this happen? And why did it happen? As we'll go back again, location has become fundamental to decision making. With an increasing digitized world, it's not impossible for governments to control maps and keep them shackled in political corridors or just use them for political one-upmanship. Over the years, maps or location technology has transformed itself from a mere mapping tool to an industry process offering value in terms of enhancing productivity in all kinds of businesses, effectiveness, transparency, and government processes. So these are some of the statistics from the Alpha Beta report. I think this was the study that Noopur was quoting initially. This is the global perspective, the study. So maps contribute to 1 trillion business sales facilitated by digital maps in 2016. 550 billion consumer benefits derived from map service, 4 million direct jobs generated, 5% improvement in revenues and cost savings by companies, 75% sectors representing the global GDP benefit directly from maps. And of course, it leads to vehicular emissions, as Pradeep shows how. So what is the geospatial Indian economy look like? Geospatial economy comprises of the following elements. If you see, market size through commercial procurement of equipment, software, data, services, and export of equipment, software. So if we see the domestic market, this is very interesting, which is where it goes beyond our popular perception of geospatial is not a consumer technology. If you see, the domestic market is equal to the government expenditure on national geospatial agencies. The domestic market is equal to 7,000 crore, and the government, the India government expenditure, direct expenditure is about 6,000 crore. So India geospatial market is worth about 7679, and this is how it can be broken into the GNSS, and which we in popular parlance is known as GPS. So the GPS market and commands a lion's share. It is about 72%, and the total market is projected to grow at the rate of 13.8% between 18 and 2021, and it is estimated to touch 11,000 crore by 2021. And India commands just 0.4% of the global geospatial market. Now, think about it in terms of Indian GDP, which is the second fastest growing economy in the world, and the fourth largest economy, GDP in PPP terms, commands just 0.4% of the global geospatial market. So where is the market distribution? If we see, it's the infrastructure, urban development, and utilities, which is taking away, which uses, has the maximum use for mapping and other kinds of location technologies, which again is important because geospatial or maps go beyond your apps on the phone. This is where your maps are being used. Every kind of map generated, even a lot of OSM maps which are generated, goes into infrastructure, utilities, and urban development. Every big ticket government project, including your smart cities, bullet train, is dependent on your real-time mapping and very fine-scale mapping. If you just look at geospatial data market, like if you cut out the software and the hardware part of it, this is the geospatial data market. So again, 83% of it is GPS-generated data, which could be very high-scale, high-grade survey done by the surveying agencies and companies like MapMyIndia. A lot of it is also generated by our smartphones, and they are put into real-time mapping like Google does, or even MapMyIndia also does, or even navigation apps, your ride-sharing apps are also. So all that data goes into the GNSS. LiDAR is a very, very LiDAR and Earth observation. This is the very fine scale. They are used for very fine scale mapping. And GIS is where you do just analytics of the data. So geospatial in India or even in Asia is diversifying, we have seen in the last few years, into new markets. The blue ones were your traditional markets earlier. So disaster management, defense, and internal security, which is one of the top consumers of geospatial data globally all over the world. And natural resource management, which includes mining and other stuff. When we look at the yellow parts, this is where the consumerization of geospatial data in the last 4 or 5 years, these are the sectors where it has seeped into. So what is driving the growth? The major growth drivers for the geospatial market in India is the thrust provided by the central and state governments. This is driven by the focus on infrastructure, governance delivery, and digital economy initiatives. Geospatial industry has so far been a direct beneficiary of the advancements in information technology. It has primarily been riding on the IT movement or the IT industry that Indian industry is known for. However, the challenge is integration of geoinformation solutions for development planning is it cannot, in the days to come, ride on IT more. It needs its own policy like ministry like IT has. So the key takeaways, if you look at services segment, drives the largest part of the Indian geospatial market. And the sizable part of the Indian geo industry caters to overseas market, just like our IT industry does. So we do a lot of servicing. We get their data, we get their problems and we deliver service or solutions for the overseas market. India imports almost all of its hardware requirements for surveying and special purpose measurement stations. Land and service segment alone is estimated to have contributed to 5,000 enterprises, which are very small surveying companies, employing nearly 2 lakh people. Indian geospatial industry, when it comes to domestic market, lacks a solution-centric approach, which is largely due to the Indian users. By users, I don't again mean the retail users, the government users or big ticket companies, who don't ask for they are more interested in asking for software or hardware boxes rather than solutions. In the earth observation sector, which is very, very strongly controlled by ISRO, and in the last couple of years, we have seen it is still loosening. So there is a huge scope for commercialization for the private industry in the earth observation sector. The major pain points, as I mentioned, there is a lack of comprehensive geospatial data policy. You'll be surprised to know there are 15 national level policies with 4 in draft stage and as many as 6 departments which control mapping and all kinds of geospatial data related policies. And all these departments, they compete against each other instead of collaborating. So each data generating agency, so be it Survey of India or be it ISRO or be it the IT ministry, each agency which generates its own data wants to regulate it, control it. They don't talk to each other. There are no data sharing guidelines. Most data, once generated, lie in silos. So once your smart city, the Department of Urban Development, if it generates data for smart cities, no other government department gets it. If the railways ask for it, they don't get it. So railways spends, again, our taxpayers' billions to generate data for mapping its own resources. In the absence of any, again, guidelines, there is no quality, authenticity, or interoperability. So these data generated by all departments, they don't talk to each other. There is a wide variety of data sets being generated, and no single window clearance because every department owns its own data, which means it takes a lot of time for any kind of data to come through if you as a private industry asks for it. And of course, there is a capacity problem. Lack of focus on geospatial as a science, as an education curriculum is churning out human resources who are just not industry ready. So if we do, I've just tried to do a SWOT analysis. If you see, strengths are typical space applications. We know that we have a globally recognized EO problem program driven by ISRO. IT industry legacy, as I mentioned, strong credentials of the Indian IT knowledge workforce and service providers. Then we have a strong institutional base, well-established and diversified centers of excellence, the scientific institutes, and presence of global companies in India. All the major even the upcoming geospatial companies are present in India because of its huge size. Our weaknesses are geospatial infrastructure, the absence of a robust geodetic and terrestrial positioning augmentation infrastructure is hindering the growth of the industry. The controls of the market barriers are, like as I mentioned, the controls of data access by spatial and non-spatial by the government forces, which limits or denies private sector participation also in a lot of projects. Then capacity development, and the fourth is low awareness and exposure on benefits of geospatial information, doesn't lead to a lot of uptake. Our opportunities are market potential. Just look at India's GDP and look at India's population, and we know why there is a huge market potential. The government demand, because of the heavy stress on infrastructure and development programs initiated by the government, this and the previous ones, in the last few years that we have seen over a decade of the infrastructure growth. So that fuels the government demand. Untapped human resource, the great, the sheer number of educated, inclined Indian population, and the commercialization of industry, which is very slow, and but which is very upbeat again. Our threats are restrictive policies, which is threatening our global competitiveness in the global geospatial market, and which could also lead to global competitiveness in terms of our growth and development and infrastructure. Piecemeal approach, there are, there is a, even within the government, we have seen because of a lack of cohesive approach, every project is taken up differently, as because the different data agencies don't talk to each other, so the project deliveries are not very successful, which also creates a wrong image or impression about the industry within the user mind, and which again leads to integrated a lack of integrated planning. This is all because of that. As we see it in the developing countries, especially if we see with a digital revolution which has been unleashed in the world, and the relevance of geospatial information and technology is continuing to build on the growth momentum, more so with a focus on sustainable development. So as we see, geospatial data and technologies have to be a cog in the bigger wheel of this process. And can India seize this opportunity?
Good morning. Yeah, you do have to pay attention because I have no slides. So your attention will be on me. So let me begin with a little story, right? Noopur was calling me about 30 minutes, an hour back. I had just given a two line saying that I'll be delayed by 15 minutes. So they were going helter skelter. While I was driving with my maps on, the context for today, and it was predicting something. But luckily the variable was less. So fortunately I could be more or less on time. Now, why am I saying this? The reason is many of the times, and we had our other speakers mention the reliability of it, right? From taking a ride to being taken for a ride, or for much more granular approach and weightage ones for the public health and safety and government organizations, how they put to use. The reliability of data becomes very, very key, right? And I thought I'll touch upon that topic a bit today. I lead the software and platforms industry practice, where software and platforms constitute today to a large part of the market. What is software and platforms? All the platforms that you use, the social platforms, the e-commerce platforms, everything constitute to that industry, and I lead that practice. And geospatial is a key aspect driving businesses there and outside of them. But one of the key aspects here is that if you see a lot of data today is created, or the creators of those data are coming from not just from OSM, but also several of these organizations. Right, I mean, Facebook is a contributor to that part, but there are also other large, platforms who generate data, right? While you have at one end who are creators of the geospatial data, there are also the others who use the base and build on top, right? For example, Grab, right? And there are several, right? I mean, you all know that. While it's very important for any of the users, how those industrial use come to play, right? I mean, if it's navigation, then you want to know the ETA well. If it's about government organizations, you need to know the census data, maybe property mapping. Karnataka has, as you may be aware, has already been working on property cards, right? Which sort of map, and you can see, go and see even in your the BBMP site, you can go and log yourself and look at the plot, look at your house, where it's located, and of course, there are lots of discrepancies, right? So why am I saying all this? The veracity of it, or the reliability of it, becomes very, very key for geospatial, both for the users of it, the B2B or B2C, as well as the creators of it, right? Now, the key challenge that comes to, and believe me, even for the largest of the large organizations, they face a lot of challenges keeping it current, keeping it reliable, keeping it trusted, simply because the nature of data is such fluid, and especially for the context that we are talking about, which is India and Asia, right? There are about three big variables. There are many, but three big ones, right? One is the variety, right? The variety of data. Say, for example, data today is picked up from your social, from your apps, from your phone, right? Which we call as a probe data, right? There are several different layers of data, which is what we call it, variety of data, right? Then there's volume of it. Now, when you see that data can arrive at different sources, different shape forms, and with the volume, the complexity increases. And then there's a velocity of it, right? Some are pretty much on a batch or a static. Say for example, satellite imagery. I mean, they don't change often. You don't have to go and do a satellite imagery, say about every 10 days, right? But several of the other data where velocity becomes very, very important. I mean, for example, if you want something real time, then the velocity of it is much almost arriving at every second. Now, to keep these three completely under control, that's what we call as veracity, or you need to keep the trust in play, right? So we've been working to really bring in that aspect of it, right? Which is, how do you keep the data trusted? So let me take a few examples, and in Indian context, right, or Asian context, how veracity becomes a challenge, and how in real life even the large platforms today sort of struggle, and of course solutions are arriving, but it will take a bit of time. So one of the examples is generally large organizations would go and start build on what they call as a reference or a base data, base maps, right? And most of the times, and everyone builds their own feature sets, right? Say for example, if it's a ride sharing, the navigation aspects become very critical. They are validating every single aspect of it, width of it, nodes, how they are adjoining crosses, where there are red lights or humps and so on, right? Now, what challenge they face is that when they build on this versus when they come to a release, a lot of changes happen in the real world. Say, for example, especially in a country like India, and you must have seen, right? So once you build and once you're developing, there are certain changes that happen. For example, the metro construction here, right? Which relatively is under control because you know that this takes months and stuff. But some are fluid, some are like, there will be an almost like a one entry that's made probably in a matter of a few days and temporarily, right? How do you keep in check those? So which means that you need to have your technology, your big data, to have one at a batch, one which is almost real time, and one which is in between. And that was one example about how do you do that. Other example is really about evidences, right? Today, a lot of fluidity happens even in what data has been represented. Say for example, a particular organization or establishment is placed in a particular building, but even the creators want to be very sure whether they are really there or are they claiming to be there, right? And hence, getting in evidences, and today they go and physically take out evidences because that's the way they've been trying to do, right? Because most often what happens is that even the AI that they plan to use a lot of times is not completely reliable in terms of, you know, taking this out, because even if you want to put in, let's say, a computer vision to, let's say, if the particular organization is there, whether they have the boards and stuff, many a times it may not be the same way that you would want to, right? And hence it becomes a challenge for them to even use technology to extract such data, right? So we are working in lot of those areas as to how AI has to play in several of these data layers, if I may say, to bring in veracity. Veracity to predict and provide the right kind of information as you want, right? Let me take a few minutes in explaining what sort of applications are being put to use to bring in this veracity. One of the stuff that we've been working is how do we put AI to really predict the parts, and this becomes critical even outside of the businesses that you would say for navigation. Let me take an example of how we used a computer vision to really predict for a large telecommunication organization, where their critical part was to replace and audit some of the data that they had as a telecom pole, right? It's simple. The only thing that they were planning to do is do it all manually, that they had to go every single pole, and this was in Australia. Australia can be a big country, right? And they had to go and verify, whether it was a utility or a telephone pole, and there are various kinds of it, right? And all they had was some information about geospatial as to where these poles were located. So we built an AI, instead of having to go physically and look at, and believe me, there was no IoT or sensor data that was there with these poles, so you could not get, there was no sort of data coming in from those poles. So we had to take geospatial data and then apply AI to train what sort of poles were there at that particular instances, and that's how the entire audit was done. This is an application of how you would do for the geospatial data. So in as a summary, what becomes critical is how do you really keep the veracity of data important when you have so many variables coming in, and with changes and dynamics of a country like India and Asia, where changes happen, even including policy changes. The policy changes, which may not be really at the government level, but even at a police constable level, right? Where you can make a street one way or open it up, depending on the kind of dynamics that the particular local market can have at that particular day and time of the day. So keeping veracity, becomes very, very critical for you to really be effective for the application of businesses, and especially where the applications will vary from being, very, very critical for ETA to being very, very critical for effectiveness of data for application, right? For as serious as maybe, public health, safety, and so on. So with this, I'll wrap, that criticality and veracity becomes a very, very key when it comes to geospatial, and that's what we're working on.
Thank you, all the speakers. So the way it will work now, given the time we have, is that I have a bunch of questions for all three of you. And I'll just summarize and say a couple of things that I gleaned from all of your presentations. So this is fascinating, thank you so much. And one of the key issues in bringing together a panel with industry experts and other kinds of practitioners is the proprietary nature of all kinds of data, including geospatial data, right? So not a lot of people are willing to talk about things, and even when we do want to talk about it, there's a very lengthy approval process to kind of make these things happen. So I'm so glad that you guys could come on board and talk about it. And in coming to your talks, in terms of coming to your talks, what I wanted to say is that yesterday we had a Facebook and OSM talk as well. And there, they didn't have enough time to kind of go into the specifics of, you know, cleaning profanity and how do you employ people, or how do you build a corpus where you clean and store all kinds of, you know, linguistic things in order to reduce profanity or check. And hence, coming back to the issue of veracity from a different angle, which is of sort of reliability of names, addresses, and other kinds of things in your own context. If you could speak generally to maintaining and what kind of human work goes into, what kind of teams do you collaborate with, and who is on ground, or what kind of infrastructure do companies invest in at their end? Because I think that's crucial if we triangulate between governments, corporates, and then community members. The real capacity for producing infrastructure and doing large-scale projects lies with the other two entities and not with individual community members. So what happens in that context, and how do you rely on people to, for example, do ground truthing and things like that? And also, relatedly, if you could speak a little bit to the pedagogical possibilities or the efforts, because as Anusuya pointed out, in terms of creating human capacity or trained people in the same industry and in the business, speaking from your own experiences, you know, what kind of capacities have you had to build, and how do you update? For example, you spoke about computer vision to some extent, so what kind of experts do you bring in, and how long-term, short-term is all of this? You don't have to speak specifically, because I understand there are all kinds of challenges, but if you could speak more generally to some of these things. Specifically to Pradeep, it was really interesting that you spoke about or mentioned, your slides spoke about the NUS study. And more selfishly, as an academic, I think something that a lot of academics and community members complain about, and you know this came up yesterday as well, is that while there is an active celebration and use of, for example, open data, there aren't quite as many equal possibilities for either community members or researchers to gain access to more interesting forms of data. It's not just about map data, but also, like you said, dynamic navigational data and all other kinds of things built on top of maps. And so if you could speak to some of the challenges or how you navigated doing a collaboration with NUS, and what can we do in the future to foster more collaborations of this sort. Anusuya, I just had like a more basic question, which is that stupid question, but what do you mean by land market distortions? And could you please elaborate sort of on the costs of, you know, a more concrete example of like what is land market distortion and what is the real cost of it? And to Srikanth, you mentioned this thing which I've been thinking about for a while, is like this, like there's metro construction or what you call fluidity. It's interesting because a lot of people would dub the same kind of things happening within an Indian or an Asian city as kind of a breakdown of infrastructure, or like an inability to kind of gain sense of what is happening within an Asian city, because it's either not as planned or not as regulated, and there are all these other factors coming into play. And so if so, then how does your team keep up with a development like a metro construction? And I'm guessing that it's very hard to keep up with that kind of stuff through AI or whatever else it is. So where do you get the news about these kind of things, or like how do you keep up with it? So I'll stop here, and then we'll take questions from the audiences.
Okay, let me start. So I think, you know, 2-3 different questions. In fact, I forgot the first one, but I'll still try to recollect. So one of the things that you mentioned was, you know, keeping vandalism at check, right? Vandalism of, when it's open, you know, then it's open for all sorts of vandalism, right? So how do you bring in, if I may say, moderation of maps, right? Just like content moderation, how do you bring in content moderation? We also, you know, sort of work and keep that at check, especially when it's open for certain, you know, edition by crowd or by users, right? Some of it, you know, is available, especially whether it's image recognition or text moderation. You know, we put to play, you know, to really check some of the vandals aspect. And also a lot of you know, aspects related to the veracity of misleading, right? It may it's also one form of vandalism where you would want to misguide a kind of an address or a location while it's not, right? So those are also you basically reference with several different data and check. So we have built in algorithms where it can detect such anomalies, right? Anomalies like where what has been given by the vandal as a certain direction or a place is not matching with your several other data sources. So and hence you throw that up. That was one part on the vandalism. The second part that you mentioned is, how critical or how is it different when it comes to, let's say, a developed nation like a US or Europe with India, where there's an interesting ad of a cement manufacturer saying that India is under construction, so which it is, right? So you will have face such problems which in a way are structured. But there are also several unstructured nature when it comes to India, right? So, for example, while I was driving, you on the same very same street, you had a part of road taken for a metro. You had a rickshaw guy who had pulled at the side because it probably had broken down. You had a handcart puller on the same road, and you had the bus and the cars, everything, and there was no dedicated lane as such. Right? I mean, this is unique because you'll also have a handcart, you'll have a bicycle, you'll have a rickshaw, you'll have the cars and other automobiles, which are not of the same way that they navigate or speed. Whereas if you go to advanced nations, there are dedicated policies and put to place on road, and which is practically working. Right? And hence, when it comes to geospatial, predicting those part becomes much more structured and easy, even for a unpredictable nature of traffic that can come in, especially in Silicon Valley, right, where I was there till yesterday, where it becomes the predictability of becomes easier because there are stricter guidelines and people follow that because the policies are laid out well. I mean, just one example is that the policy in US as to who has the first right of way, right? If there is a crossroad, the policy is very well laid out, right? And you can make out on a given particular crossroad who has the first, right of way, which means that if a vehicle is coming, perpendicular, two vehicles are coming in perpendicular angles, who will go first and who will go later, right? So there is, and hence you can always predict the nodes that you put in place, when you are automating and predicting much more accurately. Where it comes to India and Asia, it becomes challenge because a lot of it is dynamic, right? Because you can never predict a rickshaw puller who will come way in the middle of the road while he is not supposed to. So for these, it has to rely a lot more on real-time data. And that's why all of you must have, noticed when you're, and this is where I call, the fluidity or a differential when it comes to India. If it's over, anywhere between 2 to 3 miles, there is always a variance of around 2 to 3 minutes or more, depending on the time of the day, right? And these are predictability models that we plan to build, when it comes to Asian markets, where the challenge is a lot more real-time changes that happen than, a batch or a solid-state data. I hope that explained.
By land market distortion, what in our industry or what McKinsey also meant is like accurate mapping of land, and especially for government agencies. Like as we know, or many of you may know, railways is the owns the most like the largest land in India, but it also what you call unauthorized squatters, or that land doesn't ultimately belong to it, or it doesn't is not able to utilize it. So it's just when we say in popular parlance, land market distortion is for the land the government owns, or even the private industry, or even we own. So it may seem like that 1 inch, मैंने अपना घर थोड़ा बढ़ा लिया है, क्या होता है? But when a city is being planned or a road is being planned, that that 1 inch or even 1 meter being taken away or removing the unauthorized squatters, ultimately that leading to a kind of land acquisition problems, or that is what is when you quantify it is known as distortions. So most of the land in India is not properly mapped, not even the government land. We don't have some of the very developed states, like the southern states mostly, have started doing with their urban areas, like Karnataka urban areas are properly mapped. Delhi did it. It's very dated. It's 5-6 years old now. They have not updated it. We go to the villages, it's atrocious. We can't even think about it.
Unless you run out of time, there's one trivial aspect, right? How many of you are aware that there was an exercise that Bangalore took about 6-8 years back, you know, right in near Vidhan Sautha, just before high grounds. They started, and it was widely marketed that this is going to be a bridge or a magic box that will be built in 48 hours, right? It was widely claimed. They dug, they started, and they found that the entire part of the water lines and the sewers, which they had never anticipated that there was a line going under it, because it was never mapped, right? They found that, and it took close to 3-4 months for them to really build that. I mean, as simple as this, you know, having the right kind of data is missing in many of the many of the parts. As simple as sewer lines, your water lines that would have probably been laid, hundreds of years back.
Sorry, we do have to stop, but I will not let Pradeep go without answering my question. So we'll take the last response from you.
Okay, how many minutes do you have?
Five.
Okay, five. So I'll try and answer all three. So the question was, how do you look at veracity, the ground truthing, especially the kind of stuff that we do? So essentially, like all of us here know that, right? Maps are never done. It to come across a map that is fully done, there is always something to prove, there is always something more to be done. And fortunately, that keeps us all going. Such a vibrant community, we are all here because maps are never done. I hope it remains the same forever. So which means that it encourages a whole lot of people to keep giving us feedback. So in many cases, since there is tons and tons of data, fortunate that we live in some kind of world like that, data shouts at sometimes saying that, hey, this is something wrong. We suddenly start seeing pickups being very, very delayed in some places. Passengers having to walk a lot to be able to get into in some places. It starts shouting at us. Then we start looking at that and solving for it. Similarly, passengers are very vocal. They give feedback. You know all the channels through which they can talk. Hey, this was bad. This was right, kind of thing. Similarly, drivers also, in our case, do give us a lot of feedback. So this always comes in. So we look at maps as a perpetual beta. There can't be a master data set. Right, I know all of us keep talking about, hey, how about a world where everybody uses the same data set? That day is not going to come in. Because everybody will build their own data set. Everybody will want to improve things in their own way. For me, trees are important. For him, roads are important. For her, buildings are important. Right? So there's never going to be one map. I don't think any of us will live to that. But that is what makes the whole thing more vibrant. There's going to be a lot many more maps that all of us could build. And hopefully, in places like this, we all congregate together and figure out how do we help each other out, right? So treat maps as a perpetual beta. There's always improvements to be done. Instead of having exacting high standards, you say, hey, sorry, we goofed up, we cleaned it up, now here is it right. So the question is, instead of looking at how bad is your map, looking at how do you build process to get it right as soon as you hear something has gone wrong. So the question is, your time to respond to an issue, the lesser it is, the better you'll be respected. Instead of trying to build the most comprehensive, most accurate, most fresh map, look at building processes which can react to things that go wrong. Second question was around capacity building, like how do you work with experts, how do you get all of these things. So capacity for us is at multiple levels. Like since we deal with lots of data, we need tons and tons of engineers who can help come build all of the data pipeline, the data infrastructure, and all of that stuff. So when that comes into play, the data science folks get into play. Again, it comes through all kinds of shapes and forms, structured, unstructured, vision, road, GPS probe, all of that stuff, and then community feedback, and then a sense, which we do get by doing surveys and such. So the question is, how do we get all of these things done? And especially when working with the community, you need to understand the pulse of the community. There are far more communities which are very welcoming. Hey, that's good to hear that, hey, you guys are mapping my area. Then there are other communities, oh, no, this is my map. Why did you come in? Why did you change? I had to be told before we did anything. So our community team here does an incredibly wonderful job of reaching out to a lot many more people. And I'm very, very thankful to many community folks here who have helped us on this process, who have guided us. We have made tons of mistakes, but we'll learn from all of you guys. I think we will continue to make mistakes. Please pardon us and then help us out to get the right things going. And of course, the last thing is the customer support angle. Like since we run a pretty large business, lots of people shouted, say, man, this was bad. My ride didn't happen and all that. So this is a product manager's way of calling out, hey, my product sucks, right? So what most companies do is they build insurance. Like you buy insurance, right? Customer support is your insurance. If in case you build a wonderful product, you don't need customer support. But then again, you can't build a wonderful product because there will always be rough edges. You buy insurance. Insurance is in terms of customer support. You build a team to say, hey, you know what? My product doesn't cover these edges. If somebody calls you, please tell them we are sorry. And then molecule them into taking more rides with us and tell them that, hey, sorry, we'll make things. So, and then again, once it reaches a customer, we then go in and say, hey, lot many people are unhappy about this. Let's go solve for it. Because we all would like to live in a world with unlimited resources, unlimited time, unlimited money to be able to build the most perfect one. I want to see when the day comes. Until then, we have to live with imperfections here and there, right? The last part was around data, and how do you get interesting data out into the community? So I want to ask that question on the reverse side. So I have been through multiple organizations, and each of them have handled this in a different way. So when I used to work at Yahoo, so Yahoo had this huge open data set, which they called as web scope data. The, what they did was they took all the search queries that came in into the Yahoo search engine, put it as web scope. So do look it up at web scope Yahoo. You'll be able to get all their search queries and see how things work, right? So similarly, then there are other scenarios where regulation have forced companies to open data. If you look at New York, it requires taxi companies to put all the data out. So New York taxi data set is a pretty standard example for people working in this area that to look at. And then there are some other things, like for example, if you look at Uber commute, that's an attempt by Uber to be able to say, hey, I think we have all of this data, let's put it out there, and maybe we could partner with few institutions and governments, and they could go in here. So if you look through all of these three examples, right, one example is self-sourced data, like web scope. The other example is the regulation, ask me, hence the data's out there. Third is that, hey, there is somewhere in between. So if you look through all of this, it comes about this, right? Most companies do have an intent. They don't have a mal intent of like, hey, let me just hoard all the data, keep it in my storeroom, and nobody looks at that, right? And in the day where data is a commodity, there's only so much you can hoard in your secret world, suddenly saying, hey, I have the high biggest hoard. Like, what are you going to do with that? The only reason why most companies are not able to get it out there is because they have existential things that they need to solve for. And all of this putting data out requires some kind of an effort. Right, it'll require some engineering guys to come scrub the data, some privacy folks to be able to say, hey, this data is fully scrubbed. It doesn't give out places like where people live, where they go to work, and all of this stuff, and all of these kinds of things. So all of these things involves effort from engineering, regulatory, legal, and all of that stuff. So then if in case, this again, fantastic example, right? So people put some location trace data, and people were able to say, hey, just by taking three of these points, I was able to identify who this person was. You can easily disambiguate the data, even though you put a lot of effort into ambiguating it and putting it out there. Mm-hmm. Again, the research has shown that it's very, very tough for you to scrub data to be completely privacy-free. A lot of people have tried it really hard, and a lot of people also tried really hard to easily disambiguate. So it's a very, very fine balance that a large corporation has to thread to figure out how do you ensure that you help out And at the same time, how do you ensure that you protect the interests of the business as well as the customers whom you serve? So what I would urge the community is, most of these companies are very, very willing to work. So why does Grab want to work with NUS, right? So for example, when I was with Ola, I used to work with IIT Bombay, like, right? Or with Flipkart, we work with many other companies. So each of these companies works with these institutions because institutions give you a sense of safety and protection because the students don't have malintent. They work with you and they have a common goal to say, hey, I want to explore this. I'm doing this research. Probably it will help you your business in this way, then it makes sense. So similarly with government, you can say, hey, the government is interested in improving traffic in this area. Okay, we talk about that. We say, here is what we can provide you. Since it's a government, it's a trusted person. So the question is either you need to bring in an institution onto the table who, in the eyes of the public, not in my eyes, in the eyes of the public is a trusted institution through which data could be shared, or just like you are asking us to say, hey, why don't you just give the data out? Could I ask the same question reverse? Why don't you intern with us for 6 months? Work with us. Come sit in our offices, use our machines, do all of this interesting stuff, and then maybe we could publish something jointly together. Right? So I think we need to look for, hey, those guys are not giving data to, how do I ensure that it works for all of us in the system? So we need to look at creative ways to engage with everybody, with the government, with the institutions, as well as with the researchers. There is always a way. Just that the intent has to be there.
Thank you. We've overshot time by a lot, so thanks for bearing with us. And if you have more questions, they are around for the day to talk to you. Thanks.